Good evening on this rainy Friday evening. Welcome to Community Baptist Church. So good to see you all tonight. Won't you stand up with us? As you can see, there's only four of us on the stage, so we need your help singing with us. All right? So don't be afraid. Sing out. Sing with confidence. Remember who we're singing to, who we're singing for. He is worthy of our praise. So let's lift our voices to him.
Savior lives. God moves, we wait upon you, Lord. Mighty deliverer, our triumph and truth, we wait upon you, Lord. And surely as the sun will rise, you'll come to us.
For you, out of the book of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 23, it says, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us." I love that verse, because as you know, or maybe you don't know, God with us, he came to earth not just to stay for a little while and then, you know, he'll see us later. He came to be with us forever, to always be with us, to dwell in us, to never leave us nor forsake us.
You are matchless in grace and mercy. There is nowhere we can hide from your love. You are steadfast, never failing. You are faithful. All creation is in awe of who you are. You're the healer of the sick and the broken. You are comfort for every heart that mourns. Our King and our Savior forever. For eternity we will sing of all you've done. For eternity we will sing of all you've done. God with us, God compassion. There is life, there is healing in your love. You're the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and for eternity we will sing of all you've done. We sing, God with us, God for us. Nothing can come against, no one can stand between us. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that again. My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. Through the storm, we is loved. darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. With every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone. Yes, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
Let's sing Christ alone.
Christ alone.
Will you pray with me? Jesus, may that be the prayer, may that be the center of our heart, that You are the Lord of all. That we would confess that with our mouth and believe that in our hearts and cling to that truth, that You control our destiny, that You control our future. And that there's nothing that You can't handle in front of us. We thank You for that. We thank You for who You are, for what You did for us. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. 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 So good to worship together. You guys sound great. Let me invite you right now to turn around and say hi to somebody maybe you don't know tonight.
All right, well, it is good to see you guys. We are always so thankful that you guys want to take some time out of your week, especially Fridays, and come and worship with us. And so hopefully you guys are made it through the Christmas. I don't know who's already knows what they're going to do for their New Year's resolution. One person, raise their hand. That is fantastic. I love the goals that we are setting here. All right. So if we haven't met, my name is Brad. I get to be the pastor of students here, and once again, we're just thankful that you're here. Got a couple of things for you guys to do for us. If you wouldn't mind taking a moment and fill out the I'm Here card, let us know that you're here. If we haven't had a chance to meet yet, that'd be great. Also, all the information I'm going to give to you can be found on our website at findcommunity.com/this week. A lot of cool things coming up in 2017. The first thing is explore community. So this is if you are newer here, or maybe it's been a while, and so you need to be refreshed a little bit. Sunday, January 8th at the 11 a.m. service. This is a chance to kind of get to see the DNA at CBC and what's our heartbeat, and get a chance to meet the pastoral staff or some of the pastoral staff. And so this might be a great opportunity for you to come and learn about, you know, what we're doing here, where we're going, and we'd love to see you there. Also, Strengthen the Core on January, starts January 15th. This is a 7-week small group where you get to kind of dissect the 6 spiritual habits. And so we want to invite you to be a part of that. Maybe this is a great way to start your spiritual journey in 2017, and we'd love for you to take advantage of that as well. And then also we have a pajama pancake party, right? So you're not invited, but your kids are. So that hopefully, the cool thing about this pajama and pancake night where they get to you know, have crafts and games and eat pancakes, obviously, and be in their pajamas, is the cool thing is you drop them off, and then you and your spouse go and have like a 3-hour date night, and maybe it's a 3-hour nap to because you know you're trying to get through this time of year. So a lot of cool things are happening. Lastly, up in our courtyard, we still have our worship CD that our own band played and produced, and so cool. It's $10. It's up in the courtyard. I've heard great things about it. I haven't heard one bad thing. So if you don't have the CD, here's your chance to go get it. Lots of great opportunities for you to start your 2017 off on the right foot, you know, inside your spiritual journey. And we'd love to be a part of that with you guys. At this moment, if you wouldn't mind, I'd like to invite you to pray with me as we get ready to hear the message. Heavenly Father, we just thankful that we get a chance to slow down for a moment and worship you. Lord, I pray for people that have come in and they've totally enjoyed their week and they're relaxed and they had great family time and it was just enjoyable. But Lord, I also pray for everyone in between and on the other end where we're kind of coming in and we're struggling and we're dragging our feet. And so Lord, wherever we're at tonight, I pray that through Doug, you speak to us, that you challenge us, encourage us, and inspire us to live better and to live differently, to start our new year off on the right foot, to have a greater focus and love and a deeper relationship with you. It's in Christ's name. Amen.
Joy to the world.
Happy New Year. I know it's a little bit early, but we can start celebrating New Year's now. Probably a lot of you didn't know I played the saxophone. Actually, I played the saxophone and the clarinet in high school. I also played the oboe in the high school orchestra I was at, and we had an awesome orchestra. In fact, we were invited to play throughout the state of California, other high schools invited on this tour. But in order to go on this tour, we had to raise like several thousand dollars in order to fund this tour. And while my orchestra director was a great director, he was a lousy fundraiser. In fact, one of the worst fundraisers we did was selling these things. These are called resurrection plants. And I don't know, I'm from Bakersfield, and kind of looks like a small tumbleweed to me. And these cost like 10 bucks. We had to sell five of them at 10 bucks each. And I couldn't sell any. In fact, my parents, they bought one, but I had to buy the rest of them. $40 of my hard-earned cash to buy these resurrection plants. Unfortunately, my orchestra director realized the error of his ways, and we started selling candy like normal orchestras do, and we raised the money really quick. But I want to share a little bit about this resurrection plant, because it's actually pretty interesting. This is a pretty interesting thing, as long as you don't have to sell them. But these resurrection plants stay like this for many years. They're dry, they're dormant, but once they get a little bit of water, they spring to life. Check out this video here. As you can see, when they encounter water, they turn green. And most of all, they start to grow and expand. And as they expand, they also multiply as they spread their seed into the ground, creating more and more resurrection plants. You know, our lives are kind of like these plants, aren't they? There's something inside of us that's dried out, that's shriveled up, that's dormant. But when Jesus the King encounters us, it's like water to these plants. Our souls come to life. And it's no wonder that Jesus is called the living water throughout the Gospels. Because the more that we open up our lives to Him, the more we bloom and expand like this little plant. Now, we've been in this series called Building the King. And over these past several weeks, we've been looking at qualities and titles of God's King called the Messiah, called the Christ, as described in Isaiah. We've learned that this promised King of God is the wonderful Counselor, that He's the mighty God, that He's the everlasting Father, and that He's the Prince of Peace. And then last week, and if you were here at our amazing Christmas weekend services, we emphatically said, Jesus Christ is indeed this King of God in Isaiah, promised by the prophets, that Jesus comes to bring us peace, to bring us counsel, to bring us power and joy into our lives as we allow Him to lead us as our King. So what we've done over these past several weeks is looked at what the King brings to our lives. But today we're going to look more at how the King's kingdom expands in our hearts and into our world. And we're going to see that in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. So if you have your Bibles, open them up to Isaiah chapter 9. We're going to read 6 and 7. If you need a Bible, raise your hands. I'll just be happy to loan you one. And if you have the YouVerse Bible app, just click on events. You'll see Community Baptist Church, and you'll see all the notes and all the passages there. Now, we're going to see that the nature of Christ's kingdom is all about expansion. As the resurrection plant expands when it comes in contact with the physical water, so our reality expands when we encounter the living water, Jesus Christ the King. So Isaiah chapter 9, starting in verse 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Verse 7. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Now, I want us to focus on the first part of verse 7, because in the NIV, it's translated this way, of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. Now, that word that the NIV translates as greatness is the Hebrew word lemarba, lemarba. And lemarba is actually an agricultural term used to describe a plant that is totally flourishing in life. It literally means unlimited growth, fruitful growth, expansive growth, and reproductive growth. In fact, in most other translations, this word is translated as increase. You may have heard these versions where it says, of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. So it's not just the greatness of quality, but expansion, explosive growth. And not just expansion for the sake of growth, but expansion for the sake of goodness, of fruitfulness. In fact, as the prophet Isaiah tells us in this verse, It shows how the reign of the Christ, how the reign of the Messiah will expand in two ways, in breadth and in depth. And we're going to look at that. First, let's look at expansion in breadth. Isaiah first writes about the increase of government. The increase of government. The word government has to do with the breadth of reign. That is, where the reign is in effect. For example, as we talk about the breadth of the American government, there's a phrase that we use from a song to describe that. From sea to shining sea, exactly. From Atlantic and Pacific, and we'll throw in Alaska and Hawaii in for good measure. But basically, from sea to shining sea is where American laws are in effect. It's where Americans live. It's where Americans can enjoy the benefits of being Americans, such as highways and schools and water systems, to freedom of speech and freedom of religion. That's the breadth of our government. In this verse, Isaiah prophesies that the breadth of the Messiah's reign, his government, will have no end. Will have no end. In other words, the reign of Christ has no boundaries and it's constantly expanding in breadth. Jesus Christ will reign in every land. He will reign in every people group. There is no geographical limit to the reign of Jesus Christ. Eventually, as it says in the book of Revelation, every tongue, every tribe, and every nation will come under the reign of Jesus the King. But what's even more amazing is how the kingdom of Jesus Christ expands. Because unlike earthly empires that expand the reign through power or force or manipulation or imposing an ideological politics on people's system, Jesus Christ expands his kingdom in a totally, totally different way. He expands his kingdom by bringing living water into dry and thirsty hearts. His kingdom grows not through armies of war, not through economic prowess, not through internet presence, but his kingdom grows through spiritual encounter, one soul at a time. And here's how it happens. The seeds of Christ's kingdom are planted in human hearts by the followers of the King, and they do this through loving relationships and testimony. And then when these people encounter Christ, it's like their hearts come to life. In fact, we see this phenomenon, oddly enough, in the story of the Magi. You know that story in Matthew chapter 2? In fact, I'll put it up on the screen. This is the story of the Magi. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him. Now, this is a familiar story to most, if not all of us. I mean, we've heard it probably 100 times in church. We've probably sang that song, We Three Kings, just about every Christmas. And we know, just from all the sermons that we hear, that these wise men came from present-day Iraq, that they traveled about 700 miles to worship the child Jesus, and they gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, right? But I don't know, have you ever thought or asked the question, how did they know about Jesus in the first place? What compelled them to follow that star? So what I want to share with you briefly is the backstory of the Magi. And this backstory starts 600 years before the birth of Jesus. 600 years before Jesus was born, the Jewish people were conquered by the Babylonian Empire. And by the way, that was predicted by Isaiah 200 years before that. That was happened because he knew that they would not follow the ways of the Lord. So part of this was the discipline given to the Jewish people. And to add to their humiliation, the Jews were taken captive and forced to migrate from Judea and to live in Babylon, which is present-day Iraq, 700 miles away. Kind of getting it here? Now, the Jews could have thrown in the towel and just assimilated into the Babylonian culture, or they could have resisted and they could have rebelled to the point of them being exterminated. But the prophet Jeremiah exhorted them to do a third way, which is to thrive as Jewish people in a foreign land, and to build good relationships with their new neighbors, and to set a good example of what it meant to be worshipers of Yahweh, the one true God. And so they did. In fact, we read about how the Jews profoundly influenced the culture of their captives in the book of Daniel. So much so that their emperors like Nebuchadnezzar and Darius and Cyrus, that they took note of this one true God, Yahweh. And it's through the influence of Jews living amongst them that the Babylonians and later on the Persians were exposed to the writings of the Jewish prophets like Isaiah. And so they learned that from the Jews would come a very special king, the one called Messiah. And this king would be different than any other ruler in the history of humankind. That the Messiah would be a wise counselor, a loving father, mighty in righteousness, and the bringer of peace. And that was unlike any king that anyone had ever heard of up to that point of time. And not only that, but this Messiah king would not just be the king of the Jews. He would be the king over all the nations, the king of kings. And so over the next several centuries, these seeds of the Jewish faith were passed on in Babylon, later in Persia, from generation to generation to generation, until it reached the Magi in the first century. Now, the Magi were these highly trained astrologers, which means they meant that they looked to the stars as a way to interpret the future and even the present. So when they saw that star of Bethlehem, they took great notice because it was a celestial sign of such great magnitude than they ever had expected before. And something inside of them just resonated. And perhaps they were reminded of the ancient Jewish prophecies of the Messiah. And they had to find out if this King of Kings had actually come. And so that's why they made that 700-mile journey all the way into Bethlehem. And when they encountered the infant Jesus, they knew, this is the King of Kings. This is the promised Messiah. And what did they do? They worshiped him. They worshiped him. And so I want us to understand this backstory, because it's amazing to think that God had already set in motion Christ's kingdom, and that Christ's kingdom was already expanding when Jesus was just a baby for several hundred years. Before Jesus ever preached a sermon, before Jesus ever performed a miracle, before Jesus ever sent an apostle, he was already being acknowledged as the King of Kings. But as we learn about the life of Jesus and how he lived, how he gave us life on the cross, how he rose again from the dead, that's when the expansion of the kingdom took off. As you follow along in the book of Acts, Jesus predicted that his kingdom of followers would expand from Jerusalem into Judea, into Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And over the centuries, that's exactly what happened. The reign of Jesus Christ spread from the Middle East and went into Europe and went into Africa and then crossed the Atlantic, extending to North America and then into South America, and finally through missionaries reaching the peoples of Asia. And it happened one heart at a time. It happened one soul at a time, awakened by the message of the good news, combined with this amazing spiritual encounter with a living Christ. And that's how the reign of Christ got to you. And that's how the reign of Christ got to me. We are the latest of recipients in a long line of people whose hearts, like these resurrection plants, came to life through the living waters of Jesus the King. Hallelujah for that. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah for that. So that's what Isaiah was talking about this expansion of breath, of government. There would be no end. But he also talks about expansion in depth. In verse 7, he says, the increase of peace will have no end. The increase of peace will have no end. A few weeks ago, Kathleen shared a wonderful analysis of that Hebrew word for peace. Do you remember what that word was? Shalom. Shalom. Remember that? She talked about shalom. And shalom is not just the absence of conflict, but it's the total well-being that comes from aligning to God and His ways in our own lives. Shalom comes when we welcome the Prince of Peace into our lives. And here's how it works. As we allow Christ to reign in more and more areas of our lives, that shalom grows. And that shalom changes us from the inside out. And we call that process transformation. Transformation. Christ's reign expands on us in depth as we surrender our rule to His rule. And as that happens, we begin to change. We become more compassionate. We become more loving. We become wiser. We become more discerning. Our lives become purposeful and fruitful. What's happening is that we're becoming more and more like our King. We're becoming more and more like Jesus. We're becoming what the Bible calls godly, that is resembling of children of the King. And I want you to think about that time when Jesus came into your life. Maybe you were a little child, or maybe you were a teenager, maybe you were an adult, and you might have been at work, you might have been at home, maybe in the car, or you might have been at a worship service, or you might have been like at a crusade or some sort of special gathering. But there was probably one thing that we all had in common at that time when Jesus came into our lives. We were in a point of need. Maybe you needed peace. Maybe you needed direction in your life. Maybe you needed forgiveness. Maybe you needed hope. Maybe you needed meaning and purpose. Basically, what you and I really need was a Savior. And so that's why we opened our lives and our hearts to Jesus. I remember I was 16 years old. And I needed meaning and purpose to my life because I was exhausted. I was exhausted in trying to gain people's approval through achievements and through accolades, whether it was through music or through school. I was exhausted. And I remember going to this Christian concert at a church, and I saw these musicians who weren't living for the approval of man. They were worshiping God through their music. And I said, I want what they want. I want what they have. And that night, that's when I opened my heart to Jesus Christ. And you know what? Jesus encountered me. And Jesus brought in that peace, that shalom, and began to change my life. And I have to say, that was just the beginning. I mean, Jesus definitely wanted to go deeper in me. He revealed areas in my life over the past 40 years, a lot of areas of my life that needed a whole lot of help. And though it was never, ever easy, one by one, I learned to surrender those areas to His reign. And this is what happened. Whenever I surrendered an area of my life to the reign of Jesus, Jesus would encounter me and began the process of transformation in me. And sometimes that transformation was pretty quick, pretty immediate. But most of the time, that transformation was a long path that required many more surrenders and many more encounters with Jesus. And I have to say one thing about this journey of transformation that I've been on for 40 plus years is that I am so thankful that I had a lot of help along the way. And one of the big ways I was helped by the Lord was coming here to CBC, was getting involved in a church that offered so many opportunities to encounter Jesus through worship, through being in a small group, through being in ministry. And through my involvement here, I've had many spiritual mentors, people who come alongside me and help guide me through my difficult times. And through the church and through mentors, I learned to establish a daily encounter with Jesus one-on-one. We call it chair time. And I cannot tell you how many times I've encountered Jesus in the early morning through a time of prayer and worship and reading Scripture. And through this journey of 40-plus years and all the ups and downs of life, Jesus has been transforming me. And I have to say that I am living a more fruitful life. I'm living a more godly life. I'm becoming a better human being than I ever dreamed possible. And it's because of Jesus. He brought my heart to life. You see, the key to this type of life, this shalom-filled life, this transforming life, this meaningful life, this fruitful life, the key to this life is having ongoing encounters with Jesus Christ over and over and over again, where Jesus gets a little bit more of my life so that he can transform me. And that's why we are so emphatic here at CBC about engaging in the six spiritual habits. You know what those habits are, the six spiritual habits? They're worship, biblical growth, serving, giving, community, and outreach. And I want to say that these habits don't transform us. But what these habits do is they put us into a position to encounter the living Christ. And that's what transforms us, my friends. When we allow his reign to expand deeper and deeper into our lives. So the reign of the King expands to us in breath as we surrender to him. The reign of the King has expanded to us in breath because he's reached us through the many centuries of people. Expands to us in depth through his abiding presence. But the purpose for all this is that the kingdom would expand through us in our witness, in our sharing with others. You know, there's another video of the resurrection plant, which I find fascinating, but I didn't have time to show both of them. But it shows that when the resurrection plant is in full bloom, after being watered time after time after time, that it starts to spread out seeds around it so that new resurrection plants can be created. See, resurrection plants are designed to multiply themselves. And in the same way, followers of the King, we're at our very best when the King's kingdom gets expanded through us. So just as the Jews of the exile passed on the promise of the Messiah to the Babylonians and the Persians, leading to the Magi, who became the first worshipers of Christ, so God desires that reign of Christ extend from us into the lives of others. Just as generations of Christ followers passed on the living water onto their families, onto their neighbors, onto their friends, onto strangers over the centuries and over continents across the past 2,000 years, you and I are the link to those that Jesus Christ wants to expand his reign to next. Meaning our families, our kids, our grandkids, our neighbors, our friends, and people we just happen to meet. And I want to pause here for a second because I know me and I kind of know you too. And I think that whenever we think about things like outreach, whenever we think about having to share our faith with others, we get a little skittish, don't we? We get a little scared. We get a little scared because we think we have to persuade people to do something that they might not want to do. We get scared because we think we have to share a lot of Bible stuff that we don't really know a whole lot about. Or we get scared because we don't want people to get the wrong impression of us, that we're a bunch of holy rollers or religious fanatics. And I want to share with you, my friends, that the truth of the matter is that we don't have to be or do any of those things I just mentioned. All these fears that we have, we don't have to be a part of it. And while there are always ways that we can better share our faith, the only thing that is really necessary, the only thing that's really necessary is simply to be available, is to have a willing heart. And I think understanding a few realities about how to share with others might be helpful here. So I want to share three realities that might help us to be more open and to have a willing heart. And the first reality is this, that God is already at work around you and me. God is already at work around you and me. He's already preparing the hearts of those to hear what we have to share. He is sovereignly at work in every circumstance of their lives. He is at work bringing awareness to their own spiritual hunger and thirst. The second thing that we need to be aware of is that God will invite us to join in his work in the lives of others. God's the one who's going to provide the opportunities. We don't have to make things happen. We just need to be aware when God is making those things happen. And then the third reality is this, that when we're given the opportunity to share, we just need to share what God prompts us to share. That's all. We don't have to convince anyone. We don't have to win an argument. We don't have to lead anyone to make a decision for Christ right then and there. We just need to share our part of the story. In fact, we don't even need to have to share our whole story. It can be just a seed. Because remember, this is Jesus' thing. He's the king. And if he wants us to have a longer conversation with people, he'll provide that opportunity for us. We don't have to force our way. And I find that very freeing. In fact, a couple weeks ago, after Friday night church, Brad and Allison Twitty and I, we went out to Taco Chino's in Upland for dinner. Have you ever been to Taco Chino's? Man, they serve some awesome tacos. Now, Letty, unfortunately, was at home because she wasn't feeling very well. But when the three of us got to Taco Chino's, it was packed, and there was already a waiting list for the inside tables. And if you remember, a couple weeks ago, it was freezing cold and raining and all that, so we all wanted to sit inside. So we waited and waited, and finally, a large table opened up, large enough to seat five or six people. Now, there were the three of us, and there was one other couple waiting to be seated. And that's when the hostess, she must have been really brave, she came up to us and she asked, "How about the five of you sitting at the table together?" And it was in that split second that Brad and Allison and I just kind of looked at each other. And I got this sense that none of us really wanted to share the table. It was a long day. And we just wanted to eat and enjoy each other's company. And we didn't want to create an awkward situation with the other couple as well. But there was this sense that we should share that table with them. And so at the same time, Brad and I said, "Sure, we'll share the table if they don't mind." Actually, Brad told me later on that he also sensed that Allison was getting a little bit hangry. You know what hangry is? Hungry and angry. And that we needed to get the first available table or else he was going to pay for it later on dearly. So whatever the reason, the five of us sat down. And what happened in that next hour was amazing. It was beautiful. Because God gave us an opportunity to meet Kurt and Marcy, a recently married middle-aged couple. And we shared life together. It was such a delightful time getting to know one another. And during the course of our conversation, Kurt asked us, "So what do you guys do for a living?" So Brad and I said, "Well, you know, we're pastors at this church called CBC, which stands for Crazy Bunch of Christians, which would explain our behavior. And Allison was a family therapist." And you know what? It didn't really faze them. It didn't really weird them out. And in fact, Kurt said, "You know, I'm glad you're doing something. You're doing the good Lord's work to help this world become a better place." And we go, "Hey, that's pretty cool." And so we went on in our conversation. We talked about cars. We talked about family, holidays, working in stressful situations. Marcy's a head nurse at this very large hospital. And then when Kurt stepped out to use the restroom, Marcy shared with us. She kind of confided in us, and she said, "You know, Kurt is a very spiritual man, but he's not very religious at all." To which I shared, "That's awesome, because spirituality is about the soul. It's about who we are on the inside. Religion tends to be about all that outward stuff." And Marcy says, yeah, I know religion. I was raised Catholic," something like that. Anyway, it wasn't a whole lot, but you know, it was a very short conversation about spirituality. But something really significant was planted. In fact, we felt the Lord's favor on our entire time. And Kurt and Marcy must have felt the same way, because as we left, as we parted, Kurt said, "We really enjoyed meeting you, and I'm glad that we decided to share this table. And we all hope that we would run into each other again." You know, and I'm thinking that we will. I'm thinking that the Lord will give us another time in the future to connect, and maybe we could share more of our stories. And the reason why I share this with you is just to give you a simple example of how we can be an extension of Christ's reign to other people. No, we didn't share our testimony of how we came to Christ. No, we didn't share how they could become followers of Jesus. And no, we didn't get to quote any Bible verses. But Brad and Allison and I would tell you, we did what we were supposed to do. We shared life together. We did what we felt the Lord was prompting us to do. We did what was honoring to Kurt and Marcy, and we believe that a seed was planted. And perhaps it was just one seed among many, many seeds that have been planted by other Christ followers into their lives. But I believe that these seeds will sprout at the right time when Jesus encounters them, when his living water will bring their little resurrection plants to life. So my friends, I want to share that God used someone to bring you to faith in Christ. Someone planted seeds of gospel truth in your life. Someone planted seeds of gospel love into you. And if you remember, when Christ encountered you, you became a new creation as you received him in your life as Savior and Lord. So my friends, it's time for us to pass it on. It's time to allow the reign of Jesus the King to expand both in us and through us. And so as we enter into this brand new year of 2017, I want to ask a couple of questions as application. First question is, how can the reign of Christ deepen within you? How can the reign of Christ deepen within you? What step can you take to go deeper with Jesus this year? And maybe for some of you, it's having a consistent chair time with the Lord, reading the Word, praying. Maybe it's coming to worship service every week and just, instead of something that's sporadic, to make a commitment, I'm going to come and worship Christ with other followers every week. Or maybe it's joining a small group. Or maybe it's joining a Lifeline group. You know I was going to say this because Lifeline's coming up. But Lifeline is our groups that are designed to give you traction in your transformation. And we're starting up on Monday, January 23rd. And we're going to have all sorts of different groups. So maybe that's the next step, to go deeper, allow Christ to go deeper with you. The second question is, where does the reign of Christ need to expand through your life? Who do you know who needs Jesus? And I just want to give a challenge. Why not pray 5 minutes every day for 4 people you know who need Jesus? 5 minutes to pray for 4 people. You're saying, well, that leaves me another minute, right? Yeah, in that last minute, I want us to pray for ourselves so that we can see God's opportunities to plant seeds. You know, in the final chapters in the book of Revelation, the one who sits on the throne of heaven says this, "Behold, I am making everything new." Jesus is the King who brings newness and life to that which is desolate and dead. Jesus is the one who makes beautiful things spring up out of the dry ground. Jesus is the wonderful counselor. He is the mighty God. He is the everlasting Father. He is the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of government and peace, there will be no end. And so I want to remind us, my friends, this is not just the year 2017. This is the year 2017 AD. AD standing for Anno Domini, which means the year of the Lord. So let's make 2017 the year of the Lord in our lives and through our lives. Let his good reign of newness and life be extended through us. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful things that you do. We thank you that because of your living water, we are a new creation in you. And so, Lord, we just want to reflect as we go enter into this new year. What can we do, Lord, to go deeper with you? What can we do to be an extension of your kingdom to other people? We pray that you would show us, Lord, so that we can look back a year from now and say, my God, you did a mighty work this year. So, Lord, we just commit ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
This pain, I wonder if I'll ever find my way. I wonder if my life could really change at all. earth. Could all that is lost ever be found? Could a garden come up from this ground at all? You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of dust. Springing up from this old ground, out of chaos life is being found in you. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of dust.
Making me.
Thank you, Doug. What a message that I don't know about you guys, hit me like right in the heart. Absolutely, we are called to live our faith out in authentic and real ways, and absolutely we need to do that as individuals, but we also have a calling as a church to live that out as well. And so I just wanted to take a moment to talk to you guys. If you hadn't heard about this, it's the year-end drive, and we are going to step out as a church this year, and we're going to focus on creating opportunities, Jesus encounter moments for kids and youth in our community, especially those who don't know who Jesus is yet. And so we're going to step out in a real way this year, and this is maybe an invitation for you to be a part of that. Year-end drive is, if you don't know what that is, it's just a chance to give a one-time financial gift above and beyond what we normally give to create special ministry opportunities for us to be able to do this. And so maybe God is wrestling with you as you heard ways to expand Christ's kingdom in us and through us through Doug's message. And maybe there's a chance for you to partner with us as a larger body to do that in our community as well. And so at this moment, our ushers are going to come forward, and maybe it's just a moment where you need to communicate with God. Maybe he's trying to communicate with you and challenge you of 2017 is going to be different. And it's a chance for you to join in on what we've been called to do as a church as well. So if you wouldn't mind, I'll pray real quick, and I think we have one more song for you. Heavenly Father, we just lift this offering to you, that you use it in a way that we could never dream of. And so we ask that you bless it and bless the people who give, bless those who are wrestling with maybe giving and taking next steps in their relationship with Christ. But we thank you and we love you. Amen.
Fire fall again. It's burning in my soul.
Let's give our thanks to our worship team for being here. And this guy is getting married in a week. And so is Holly. They're getting married to each other. So a week from tomorrow, man. So we're so excited for you guys. So what a great way to start 2017, yeah, for our church family. So let's let the fire burn in our soul. Our prayer team is here to pray with you, to come alongside with you. And as we leave today, let's just receive this blessing. Jesus says, "You, my friends, are the light of the world. So do not hide that light under a bushel, but let it shine for everyone to see. He is doing a good work in you, and he desires to do that good work through you. So let it burn in your soul. Let your light shine. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen." God bless you.